Welcome to Octopussy Special Edition DVD. Please activate your navigation system now.
Welcome back, Bond fans. This is D-Wzp's podcast, episode 50. So, I have returned. I know you guys haven't heard from me for a little bit. I just decided to take a break, just to slow down and ease my mind and deal with life. I think it's good to take a little bit of a mental break, especially given everything that's been going on this year. But I'm back here to talk about more movies. So if you guys are new to my channel, this is a podcast channel talking about all the things in the world of film. So if you guys love talking about movies and enjoy what I do, please hit that like button and subscribe to the channel. And don't forget to hit that bell to be notified on future videos I'll be doing. But today we're continuing on. Today we're continuing on talking about the James Bond 007 franchise. We're talking about all 24 James Bond films leading up to the 25th Bond film, No Time to Die, which is scheduled to come out this November. I've already talked about the previous Bond films up until this point, from Dr. No to For Your Eyes Only. So if you want to check out my thoughts on the previous movies, I'll leave a link in the description below to my playlist called James Bond 007. But today we will be continuing on talking about the Roger Moore era Bond films. We'll be talking about Octopussy. Those of you who are wondering, Captain Eagle probably won't be joining me for the rest of the Moore films because honestly he doesn't have much to say about these two. Hopefully I'll have him back for the Dalton films. But yeah, so it's just me today, but we're gonna have some fun talking about Bond as always. So without further ado, hold on tight and let the flight begin. Sorry, that was pretty corny. Gun barrel, please.
Enjoy yourselves.
Octopussy. So this is the 6th Roger Moore film, and this is the 13th James Bond film of the entire franchise. This came out in 1983. Okay, so if you guys have been following up on our Bond reviews, the last one we talked about is For Your Eyes Only, and I thought it was okay. Definitely not my favorite Moore film, but I thought it was decent. And I felt like they made up for all the over-the-top silliness that Moonraker had. And there was some really good, I think it was one of the more grounded movies that Roger Moore has done in this franchise, which I really appreciated. So up until this point, Roger Moore has done 5 Bond films, and I felt at this point I got my Roger Moore's worth. You know, he's done a good amount of movies, so me, I felt like I was ready to move on to another actor. You know, after rewatching the Moore films up until this point, I got more of an appreciation of Moore as Bond. At first, I wasn't really loving him. You know, I wasn't really loving his portrayal. Felt like the other actors were stronger. I still kind of feel that way, but You know, I actually do thoroughly enjoy him as Bond. You know, he had his own unique style to it, and I feel now he still has that essence of Bond. You know, he still has the spirit of it somewhat. But yeah, so after For Your Eyes Only, I was just, you know, I'm ready to move on to another Bond. And that's what the studio was, that's what the studio was going to do at first. They were actually doing, auditions for an American actor to play Bond, which is actually interesting because, you know, we've never had an American actor play James Bond. So I actually thought that would have been interesting. I watched the screen test with the actor that was the runner-up to be Bond. His name's James Brolin. I think he's the father of Josh Brolin. Not fully sure. That's what Captain Eagle brought to my attention. Which, if he is, that's really, actually really interesting. That's really cool. But anyway, I saw James Brolin's screen test to be Bond. It's online if you guys want to watch it. It's on YouTube. You could just look up James Brolin Bond screen test, you'll find it. But I watched it and I actually thought he was pretty decent. I was pretty interested to see what he would have done as Bond. But sadly, that's not exactly what happened. So behind the scenes, one of the owners of the rights of Bond, his name's Kevin McQuarrie, and there's this whole rights war between him and the MGM, I think, and you know he owns certain rights to names and stuff from the franchise, and he was really bitter to MGM for some reason, and so what he decided to do was make his own unofficial Bond movie to rival the main Bond films. I don't understand his mindset with it. Like, I don't know why he's trying to sabotage the main Bond films. Like, I'm sure there's, like, drama stuff going on behind the scenes, but I just felt this was really immature and ridiculous. So, yeah, he ended up making his own Bond movie to compete with the next Bond movie that MGM was going to make. And surprisingly enough, McQuarrie was able to get Sean Connery to return as James Bond. What? I don't understand how he was able to do that, but hey, it happened. So yeah, McQuarrie made an unofficial Sean Connery Bond movie. It's called Never Say Never Again. I watched the movie, and I didn't like it at all, in short. It was so bad. I don't know what McQuarrie's mindset was for that movie, but it just felt like a waste of time. It didn't feel like a Bond film. It just felt so obscure. And Sean Connery, I don't understand how they got him back. I'm not gonna go into a full detailed review on it unless you guys want me to. If you guys want me to review Never Say Never Again, leave a comment below, and if I get enough comments, maybe I'll visit that one and do a review for you guys. But in short, it was not very good. But the reason why I bring this up was because of this, MGM pretty much got scared and abandoned all the plans they were about to do with James Brolin and decided to bring back Roger Moore for another Bond film, which I'm like, I don't know how their mindset was back then, you know, because I wasn't born when the movie came out, but you know, just me looking at all this stuff going on, I personally didn't think they needed to do that. I mean, yes, Sean Connery's coming back as Bond, but I felt like James Brolin would have been good competition with Connery, you know. Like, it felt like they didn't have enough confidence in this actor to, you know, to combat Connery, which I know Connery is, you know, the one that started it all. He's legendary, but you know, he's aged. He's past his prime. So I have no doubt in my mind that James Brolin would have still done a decent job against, you know, against Connery. So I'm kind of frustrated about that. And then on top of that, you know, Roger Moore is getting old himself. He's getting up there in age. So it's like, it's going to be the battle of two old Bonds. So that's not really something I really care about, to be honest with you. But, you know, it is what it is. We ended up getting another Roger Moore film. But yeah, in regards of my viewing experience with this, this is another Roger Moore film that I didn't know existed at the time when I first watched the Moore films. Yeah, I didn't end up seeing it till like years after I watched The Man with the Golden Gun and Spy Who Loved Me and stuff like that. When I saw the title of this movie, I was like, this is, it's such a dumb title. Like, Octopussy? I don't understand. I mean, I know it's like, it's a running joke for this franchise, but it's like, I just don't understand. Why would you title the movie this? Like, it's so dumb. It's probably one of the worst titles I've in the franchise to me. Like, I didn't know how to feel about this. But you know, getting into my actual thoughts on this movie. How does this stack up with the other Moore films, and how did this stack up against the rivaling unofficial Bond movie, Never Say Never Again? Well, I can say up front that it's definitely more watchable than Never Say Never Again, which is, you know, something I figured was going to happen regardless. So yeah, one positive, yes, this is better than Never Say Never Again. But that being said, it's not that great either. This movie's a mess. But yeah, I felt like the story and the narrative of this movie is all over the place. There's some unnecessary humor again. There's characters introduced in this movie that are underutilized and like borderline wasted, and the performances are so over the top. But yeah, I don't think this movie is awful, but you know, this one's not very memorable compared to the previous movies. But yeah, I guess we could start talking about the pre-title sequence. So it starts out with Bond at a military base in Cuba. He's infiltrating the base with the help of a Hispanic chick. I don't even remember if they say her name or not, but so his plan was to go to this military base and blow it up. And he disguises himself as one of the military officers. He attempts to take a bomb and plant it on one of the devices in the base, but they end up catching him and realizing he's undercover or whatever, so they capture him, and then they transport him in one of the trucks to somewhere, and then the Hispanic chick is driving up next to the truck that Bond is in, and the Hispanic girl shows off her legs to the military officers, and they get all googly-eyed over it, and that gives Bond the distraction to escape from the truck and get on the Hispanic girl's car, and then he gets into what we think is a horse carriage, but it turns out it's actually a truck holding a jet that he uses. It's like a white jet with blue and red stripes, which I thought the jet was pretty cool. So he flies the jet, and then the military officers fire a missile at him, and the missile's chasing after Bond and the jet. And then he ends up luring the missile in the base, because he ends up flying through the military base, and then the missile follows it, and then ends up blowing the base with the missile. So I thought that was a pretty entertaining start. So far we're on a decent note. I thought it was odd though that the jet that Bond was in ran out of gas so quickly. I don't know why they didn't make sure that the jet was fully fueled before bringing it on a mission, but whatever. So when the jet's running out of gas, he lands the jet at a gas station, and he pulls up perfectly next to the gas station, and then there's this guy that works there that's standing in front, and then Roger Moore stops and says, "Fill her up, please." So it's kind of cheesy, but it was entertaining enough. And then we get into the main titles and the theme. Okay, so talking about this theme, what is up with these romantic ballads in the Moore films? Like they back to back, we keep getting romantic ballad after romantic ballad after romantic ballad. The Spy Who Loved Me, Moonraker, For Your Eyes Only, and now this. Thank God that this movie doesn't incorporate Octopussy in the song. I think that would have been too much. That would have been so stupid. But I'm pretty much going to be saying the same thoughts I have with the other romantic ballad themes. Like, as a song by itself, it's pretty good. I like the song on its own. It's a nice song. I personally just don't care for romantic ballads as Bond themes. I mean, like I said, I know Bond is a ladies' man, so that's something that we're, you know, accustomed to. But, you know, me personally, I just like a more exciting Bond theme or something that's a little bit more eerie and dark. You know, I don't know, it just takes me out a little bit with this whole, you know, this whole lovey-dovey stuff. We're in all-time high. This is all that's gone before. Doing so much more than falling in love. I'm like, what? I don't know. Yeah, Rita Coolidge is singing the song. Like I said, it's not bad. It's nice, but I don't know. It just seems odd to me. I don't know. Comment below what you guys think about romantic ballads in Bond themes. Like, do you guys enjoy the romantic ballad Bond themes, or, you know, you guys prefer something more exciting or more eerie? But anyway, as far as the main titles are concerned, they're pretty good. I like the laser effects on the girls. There's like laser images that come out of the girl's gun, which, okay, that's kind of cool, I guess. And there's like this strobe gaslight effect, and there's a silhouette of Roger doing a roller skating twirl with a girl, which, you know, I normally don't care for silhouettes in Bond titles, but, you know, that was pretty nice, I guess. That's a nice image, I guess. But yeah, the titles are decent. Not much to say about them. It's just, you know, not too much going on with it, but, you know, they're decent. But anyway, going into this plot, it's like I said, the plot's kind of a mess. Like, so this whole thing is based off of this, you know, this Russian military stuff. One of the generals, which is, I guess, one of the main villains of the movie, General Orlov, he has this whole plan to take over the West with, you know, with the Russian military. Which is, you know, kind of contrived how he's trying to go about this. And on top of that, General Orlov himself, I didn't care for him as a villain. First of all, he's just so mustache twirling and over the top. I think that's kind of how I feel about the other Russian generals in this movie. Like, there's literally a scene where they're all talking in a boardroom or stuff, and everyone's talking like an Imperial officer from Star Wars. Like, oh, we want to take over this part of the Western part of the Western part of the world. No one can stop us. Like, no, we cannot attack them. We must show our dominance. Blah, 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 blah. I'm like, what is this? What's going on right now? But, like, the way he's trying to go about invading the West, it just seems all contrived, you know? And then it's like, Orloff is trying to smuggle a bomb with the help of Kamil Khan to blow up part of the West so he can get his military there, and he's using Octopussy's circus that she owns to transport the bomb on the circus's train. The first quarter of the movie, we're not even, like, focusing on that too much. We're focusing on this stupid, egg. Like, whatever, this Fabergé egg. That seems to be the MacGuffin for the most of the film until we get to, like three quarters in. Like, this whole Fabergé egg subplot, I could have done without. I mean, I'm not saying... I mean, if they actually explained the importance of this egg more, I would be more invested in it, but, like, it ends up being inconsequential by the time we get towards the third act of the movie. So, like, it literally starts with, Agent 009, he's out on the field, and he's disguised as a clown, I guess because he's coming from a circus, he's doing undercover stuff, whatever. And he's getting chased by these twin acrobats that throws knives, so that's their gimmick, I guess. There was a nice little scene where misdirect scene when he's getting chased by one of the acrobats, and he thinks he lost one of them, and then the other one pops up behind them, and we were thinking at first, okay, wait, do these acrobats know how to teleport? But then it turns out that they're twins. And so I thought, okay, that's pretty interesting. But anyway, 009 is trying to get this egg to the British Embassy, and he ends up getting killed in the process. So then they're explaining where this egg possibly comes from, and it ends up being the property of Octopussy, who we'll get to in a minute. But he sends one of the people he's associated with, Kamil Khan, who ends up being the other main villain of the movie. He ends up sending Khan to get this egg for reasons, I guess. I guess, like, Octopussy likes her, you know, Fabergé eggs and, you know, jewelry or whatever. So there's this whole auction thing that they have that bonds there, and I mean, the auction scene was nice. It was pretty cool scene, you know, because Bond's trying to outbid Khan for the egg, and he's just doing that to make Khan pay more for the egg, which, you know, made him upset. So but anyway, yeah, this egg I don't really care about. They keep telling us how important this egg is, and they don't explain why. One little thing though, when they're talking about the egg at MI6 and they're reading about it in this book, and it says property of a lady, and at that point I was thinking, so the egg is the property of Octopussy, and I was thinking, why didn't they title this movie Property of a Lady? Like, because to be honest with you, this movie's not really about Octopussy. Like, it's really strange, too, because, you know, the movie's named after her, but to be honest, they barely utilize her in the film. Which, I mean, we'll talk, like I said, I'll get more into details on her in a minute. But, yeah, I was just sitting there thinking, like, why don't they just call it, why don't they call this movie Property of a Lady, since this seems to be the main focus for most of the film, you know? Fun fact, actually, that was going to be the title of one of the Timothy Dalton Bond films, Property of a Lady, but they didn't end up doing that, so that's why I'm bringing that up now. I'm like, they could have just titled this movie that instead of instead of Octopussy. But anyway, I'll talk about more about the villains of the movie. Kamel Khan, he's fine. Like I said, he's just a typical villain. Not much to him. He does have a decent, you know, commanding presence and stuff like that. And he's actually pretty smart. So, he's not all bad, but, you know, he seems kind of forgettable. Probably because, you know, there's so much happening in the movie. And then there's the main henchman of the movie, Gabinda. He's not as memorable as Odd Job or Jaws, but he serves his purpose. He's just the typical muscle man, and he ended up having some decent action sequences with Bond and stuff like that. And then there's the henchwoman of the movie, Mokhtar. She was somewhat interesting. She reminds me of the redheaded girl from Thunderball. Like, she has a really, like, eerie demeanor to her. She's kind of creepy, but, you know, I found that really interesting about her. But we don't really spend that much time with her. You know, it's like I only remember her in like two scenes. One of them trying to seduce Bond for the egg. But yeah, you know what? Let's just talk about Octopussy herself. You know, so she's a returning actress. She's played by Maude Adams. She was in The Man with the Golden Gun. So I actually thought that was interesting to bring returning actress back. As far as, you know, I felt like there was some interesting concepts with her in this movie. When she's first introduced, we don't see her face, and we just only hear her voice, and I thought that was a really cool introduction. You know, it reminded me a lot of Blofeld when they don't show his face in the first couple of movies, and it had a really, like, eerie, mysterious introduction to her. So I'm thinking, oh, they might build her up to be maybe the main villain, antagonist, or whatever. She could end up being, you know, a more memorable villain, but that's not really what ended up happening. I thought she was fine. She was fine. I feel like the idea of her is more interesting than her characterization, you know, herself. Yeah, I think she's definitely more interesting than in The Man with the Golden Gun. I just felt like there was some missed opportunities with her overall, because, you know, they have all these interesting ideas. You know, she's like this millionaire or whatever, owns her own island, and she has this all-women's cult, you know? It's like, I wanted to learn more about that. That's really interesting. It's something... I mean, that's the concepts they kind of play with the previous movies, you know, women having their own, like, culture, whatever. But, like, to have, you know, one of the main characters have her own, you know, cult, you know, that are raiders themselves and, you know, warriors or whatever. Like, that's really interesting. I want to know more about that. But they're just eye candy, you know. So I just felt that was a missed opportunity. And then... You know, me personally, I think it would have been interesting for Octopussy to acknowledge the fact that she's the same character from The Man with the Golden Gun, since they brought back the same actress. Like, I think it would have been interesting to have that character from Golden Gun, you know, have more development as a character, and she ends up being this, you know, possibly, you know, anti, if you don't want to make her a main villain, this, you know, this anti-hero type of person. It'll be an interesting dynamic with Bond, because they already, like, allude to the fact that she already knows who Bond is, and then she's talking about how Bond killed her father, I guess, and she was saying, like, she thanks Bond for giving him a satisfying end or whatever. So, I mean, how cool it would have been if instead of, you know, it being her father, it could be Scaramanga, you know? That would have been really cool. And then she could talk about how she came up to power and stuff like that, but that doesn't end up happening. Even like with Mokta, they tease that, you know, she's possibly, you know, part of her octopus cult, you know, because when, you know, when Bond and Mokta sleep together and Bond notices that she has the octopus tattoo on her lower back. And she, oh, that's one other thing I'll talk about that scene. That was just how dumb her name was, you know. When Bond notices her tattoo, he's like, "What's that?" And then, I shit you not, I was actually drinking water when this was happening. She turns around and says, "Oh, that's my little Octopussy," and I literally spit water because of how stupid that sounded. That, I mean, why is she called that? Why is she called that? Like, why are they called the Octopus Cult? Like, because they don't go into that enough, you know, with them just keep saying the name, it just sounds stupid. There's no weight or resonance to the name, you know, instead, outside of it being like a, possibly a inside gag, you know. So that's why I just have such a problem with this name, you know. Pussy Galore and Goldfinger, I still probably think that's like the silliest name of the franchise, but this is a close second. Like, I don't understand. But anyway, back to Octopussy herself. She's like I said, so when Bond and Octopussy end up having feelings for each other, like, it just feels empty, cuz for one thing there's no build up to it. It just happens. Like, they just talk about, she talks about her going to other parts of the world to expand her cult or whatever, or helping with charity or whatever. And Bond says he can't go because he's committed to MI6, and then Octopussy gets mad for some reason, then she storms to her room, and then Bond just follows her, and then they have sex.
You alright? We are two of a kind.
I'm like, okay, we're just gonna do this out of nowhere? Like, so it would have had more resonance if, you know, if Octopussy was the same character from Golden Gun. Maybe, and then that probably would feel a little bit more earned, but the fact that she's pretty much a different character, it just falls flat, that whole romance thing with her and Bond. But yeah, is there anything I did like in this movie? Yes, there's some decent action set pieces in here. I found them for the most part entertaining. There's a lot of Indiana Jones influences in this movie as far as the action sequences. Since they are in India, the similarities are there. I like the taxi chase sequence in India. I thought that was very entertaining, and Bond meets his contact there, Fijay, who's actually a tennis player in real life. So I don't know much about him, but I'm guessing it's pretty cool that they got a famous tennis player to be in the movie. I thought he was pretty decent. But yeah, he had some pretty cool set pieces with Bond, with the taxi chase and stuff like that. Of course, they gotta throw in some gags with the tennis racket, because, you know, he's a tennis player, so he gotta fight with a tennis racket. And I thought that was kind of silly, but, you know, still entertaining enough. And there's some stereotypical, you know, gags in here, like guys on a spiked bed and swallowing swords and walking on hot coals. But, you know, at least it was entertaining enough. And then there's a chase in the jungle with Bond. It was entertaining, but that I felt was a little bit more silly, especially because, you know, he starts out because they capture him in a body bag, and then he scares the people going in the body bag, which I thought was kind of silly. And then it leads to Bond, getting chased by Kamel Khan and his goons, and he runs into snakes, alligators, leeches, and a tiger. And he, when he confronts the tiger, Bond literally tells the tiger to sit, and it sits. I'm sorry, that's not how that works. I don't think a tiger would just sit, you know, on command. So I thought that was really cheesy. And then there's literally a scene where Bond is swinging on a vine, and you hear the Tarzan yell. They literally incorporate the Tarzan yell sound in the movie. I don't understand why they did that. It was so stupid. But outside of that stuff, I mean, yeah, decent set pieces, like Indiana Jones influences, but, you know, not really enough to be like, oh, this is such a good time, you know. It just, like, it keeps my attention enough where I don't fall asleep. And then there's a train sequence towards the end of the movie, which I thought was entertaining enough. But once again, more Indiana Jones influences. I thought it was an entertaining train sequence scene. And there's a airplane sequence for the climax, which I thought was cool, but, you know, I had to suspend my disbelief a little bit because, you know, Moore is getting up there in age, so it's hard for me to believe that someone his age is able to hold on to a plane on the outside while it's up in the air, and then fighting, and then he's fighting Gabinda on top of the plane, which I thought, oh my gosh, this is freaking crazy. There's also this fight scene in Octopussy's palace where there's some assassins, and one of them has a yo-yo buzzsaw, which I thought that's pretty cool. That's pretty entertaining. That's a unique concept, a yo-yo buzzsaw. Like, I thought that was pretty cool. Which also leads to one of my other issues with the movie, which I feel is kind of a plot hole. After that whole fight scene with the assassins in the palace, Bond fakes his death to Octopussy, and I didn't understand that because, you know, before that point, you know, they ended up being allies and they sleep together, so it's like, why did Bond need to do that? Why didn't he just go back into the palace and tell Octopussy that he's alive and tell her about Khan's plan? Like, I think it would have saved a lot of time instead of just going through this whole thing of, oh, you gotta chase after Octopussy on the train, and you gotta disguise yourself at the circus and tell her what's really going on. It's like, that whole thing could have been avoided, or we could have resolved the conflict quicker if he just, you know, went back to talk to Octopussy. I didn't understand that. And it made the movie longer than it needed to. And then it leads to, the circus scene where, you know, he disguises himself as a clown, and that's an image I didn't really need to see. I really didn't need that. Like, We've gotten to a point where Bond has to dress up as a clown, and it's really odd because he's taking himself seriously in the scene when he's trying to, you know, meet up with Octopussy. It's just so weird. It's just so odd. He has like 4 or 5 different costume changes in this movie. I don't know why that is. Like, he dresses up as a clown and as a general, as one of the twin assassins, and as a gorilla. Wait, why is there a gorilla suit in a circus? Like, these are just, I mean, these might be nitpicks to people, but I'm just like, I don't know why this is in the movie. But yeah, to talk about real quick about M and Moneypenny, and Q. So M is played by a new actor. His name's Robert Brown. I thought, yeah, he's a decent replacement. Not too much to say about him yet because he only has, like, I think one scene in the movie, which is, you know, the briefing at the beginning of the movie, as we usually see with M. But I think he's a decent replacement. He was also one of the naval officers from The Spy Who Loved Me, so he's another recurring actor. So I like to think that's the same character coming back to, you know, take the place of M, since the previous actor passed away. So I'm thinking, okay, this is a new recruit. I'm not thinking that Robert Brown is playing the same character that the previous actor is. So that's how I like to think about it. And I think that holds weight because when we eventually get to Judi Dench in the future Bond movies, that makes more sense. And then Moneypenny, I thought it was interesting that they introduce someone that's training under her wing, you know, to possibly take her place when she retires. Believe her name was Smallbone, which that's another silly name. But I thought that was interesting. I'm glad that they're acknowledging that Moneypenny's getting a little older, and you know, it's cool to see her train somebody to be the new Moneypenny. You know, because they don't really want to acknowledge the fact that Roger Moore is getting older, so I'm glad they did it with, you know, at least with Moneypenny. So I thought that was an interesting concept. And, you know, I'd be interested to see if Smallbone comes back, how she could be incorporated into the franchise, you know. And then Q, I thought he was cool. I like that he was able to help Bond in the field for a little bit. He helps Bond get to Khan's lair with the hot air balloon, so I thought that was pretty funny. I like that. Yeah, as I said before, I enjoyed the I like the climax with Bond and Octopussy, and then she also brings her octopus cult to fight Kamel Khan at his other lair, and which led to the airplane fight. I thought that was all entertaining. I thought that was pretty cool seeing the octopus cult fight and, you know, seeing what they're capable of. And then it ends with the, you know, the final boat scene where Octopussy and Bond is you know, relaxing on one of her boats, and she has a bunch of ladies rowing the boat, and one of the ladies is commanding the girls that are rowing in out, and that's supposed to be a double entendre because Octopussy and Bond are having sex in the boat, which I'm like, okay, that's kind of that's really silly, but you know, that's what I come to expect with these earlier Bond films. So yeah, overall I thought the movie was meh. I felt it was all over the place as far as plot and, you know, the narrative and the character development. I felt like there was characters that were underutilized, but they had interesting concepts, so I thought that was really disappointing. And the whole MacGuffin with the egg, I thought was a waste of time. And the villains weren't that great. I mean, Kamel Khan was alright, but General Orloff, I thought he was just a mustache twirling villain. I literally forgot about him halfway through the movie. I didn't even care when he died or whatever. But yeah, and the title of the movie I just thought was really silly, especially the fact that it doesn't feel like this movie focuses on Octopussy enough for it to be named after her. So, I don't know. I didn't feel, and as far as the Roger Moore coming back, I thought he was fine, you know, but I felt like his presence didn't really impact the movie that much, outside of people who are, you know, already on board and huge fans of Moore. But outside of that, like, I really think you would have got this similar quality if you got a new actor. You know, I don't think bringing Roger Moore back really impacted the film that much, but he still did a pretty decent job. I just would like for them to acknowledge the fact that he's older, because he's still doing slightly perverted stuff in this movie. Like, I remember back in Q Branch, when, you know, Q's recruit informing him on the stuff on the mission or whatever, He takes a telescope in the Q branch and he zooms in on one of the secretary's boobs, which I'm like, and he's twice her age. And like, I just, this that stuff just kind of weird. Like, this is probably why I was not, I wasn't loving Roger Moore as much as the other actors, because I felt like, you know, in his later years, it just feels, he doesn't feel like the heartthrob that he normally is, because he's so old. And so when he's trying to flirt with these younger women, it just feels weird and uncomfortable. So I'm like, I just wish they acknowledged that more. But, you know, overall, I thought this movie was meh. It was not a Bond film I would like to revisit. I still feel like I got my solid Moore slate up till For Your Eyes Only. So overall, I'm going to give this movie a 5.1 out of 7. But that's how I feel about Octopussy. What did you guys think about it? Did you guys love it? Did you guys hate it? Did you guys think it was okay? Comment below and let me know. So I would love to say that this is the last Moore film I'll be talking about, but sadly that's not the case still. Because the next Bond film I will be talking about is the final Roger Moore outing, A View to a Kill. Not looking forward to that one. But tune in for that when it comes out. But that's all I have for you Bond fans, and I will see you guys in the next one. I'll talk to you guys later. Bye-bye.